Good morning to all. So we begin with the online class. I, Ms. Nirupa Rochand, am going to teach biology of class 11th, chapter 2, and we have this part 3. So in the previous topics we have done, in the previous parts we have done the Kingdom Monera, Kingdom Protista, and today we are going to start with Kingdom Fungi. In the first category, you remember that in Kingdom Monera, there were prokaryotes and unicellular. In Kingdom Protista, we have seen that they are one step ahead, and that is they are eukaryotes having a well-defined nucleus as well as unicellular. Now we come to the third kingdom, that is Kingdom Fungi. In Kingdom Fungi, children, there are two major characteristics that you have to remember. The first is that they all are multicellular. And as you know that there is one exceptional feature, that is the yeast. And similarly, they all are decomposers. Decomposers means they decompose or break down the complex organic matter into simpler forms. So as a result, we find that the broader outline is that they are all multicellular except one, that is yeast, and they all are decomposers. The general characteristics of the Kingdom Fungi. Now this is one of the picture I have shown here. You must have commonly seen this mushroom going around during the monsoon time, and we find that you will see them around the logs and in the places where there are a lot of garbage or wet garbage. So these type of umbrella shaped structures are seen. So they all are the organisms belonging to Kingdom Fungi. The general characteristics involve the cell wall is made up of chitin. Now this chitin is making up the cell wall of the fungi. Saprophytes, they are saprophyte, means they depend on the other organisms for their food. They are not able to prepare their own food. They are eukaryote, and the study of fungi. Now there is a branch of biology which deals only with the study of fungi, and that is called as mycology. They are spore-bearing animal organisms. We can say why? Because they only have spores. So they give rise to the new organism of their own kind by the production of these spores. They are achlorophyllous. A, I already told you, means without. So they do not have chlorophyll. Coming up to the basic structural plan of the fungi, we find that they are made up of hyphae. Hyphae is the main structure. They are thread-like structures, okay, which form a dense network. Now, individually, they are single thread-like, we see them, and they have nucleus in them. So you can see the nucleus is there. They possess cytoplasm and, of course, the cell wall around them. But we find that these hyphae, which are the single thread structures, they form multicellular or form a large network and dense network, and they are called as mycelium. So that mycelium is, therefore we are not able to actually see the hyphae or a single structure of fungi. We see them as a different form, actually that is because of the dense network formed on them. Now, their hyphae may be cenocytic or the septate one. Now, we find here, if you see here in this diagram, they do not have a wall partition. So all the nuclei are free in the cytoplasm. Whereas if you see the above diagram, they have wall formation. Within the limited wall, there is only one nucleus. So as a result, they have called as septate hyphae. Septate means the wall formation. And here they are called as cenocytic hyphae. Now, another type of structure that comes out from the hyphae, and in order, this is basically done to derive the nutrition from the other plant or organism. So you can see a single hyphae with a nucleus, and it is a septate hyphae, as you can see in the diagram. It's bringing out its extension, which goes into a host cell. And this structure is called as the hostoria. So they are specialized structures coming out from the hyphae to allow them to take the nutrition or derive the nutrition from the host cell. So in this category, we have two types. One is a single type, you can see, a knob-like, and sometimes they form a dense network inside, means they form further branches. So you can see here, once entering into the host cell, they may further form branches. Now the nutrition, because they cannot prepare their own food, achlorophilous they are. So they are heterotrophic and they obtain their nutrients as saprophytes, there are different forms of them, as parasites or as symbiont. Now saprophyte means that they depend on dead and decaying matter. So by depending on the dead and decaying matter, they are considered as the saprophyte. Parasite, when they depend on other living organism as their food or their survival. Symbiont means they live in close association with the other host body. You cannot call it host, but they live in a close association whereby both benefit to each other. The best example is of lichen, which we will be doing in the coming class. Now we have further the classification of fungi. The fungi is further classified into the first type, that is zygomycete. Now the best example is of mucor and also the rhizopus. They are commonly found in the bread, the normal bread that we eat. You must have observed a number of times during the rainy season that the bread, if kept for a long time, we find that they develop somewhat a green structure or a white mark over them, which further converts to green and then ultimately it becomes black in color, and that all is the formation of the spore. Now the general plan of their structure is they have three types of hyphae. The hyphae which remains on the surface of the bread, that is called as the stolon hyphae, and the one which goes down, that is called as the rhizoidal hyphae, and the one which comes above to give rise to fruiting body or in which the spores will be formed is called as the sporangiophore. So likewise we find that they have three types of hyphae: stoloniferous, rhizoidal hyphae and sporangiophore. In short, they are called as stolon, rhizoid and sporangiophore. Now sporangiophore is this hyphae, the erect one or the upright, which will end up to form a sporangium, a sac-like structure above, and within this sporangium we'll find that spores will be formed. These spores, as you can see here, they are zoospores. They are usually called as zoospores and they cannot move on their own, so they are called as non-motile. They are non-functional. They cannot move from one place to another on their own. So they are made to spread. Now this wall of sporangium burst and all the spores are thrown here and there without any other way. So here we find that sporangiophore are the asexual spores at the tip of the hyphae. And then one of the example, rhizopus, here they have given the example of mucor. The next classification under the hyphae is the ascomycete. Now ascus, the word, if you break the word, it means sac or somewhat bag-like structure. So these fungi, they bear a bag-like structure for holding the spores. Basically, their reproductive sac is known as the ascus. They are mostly saprophyte or parasite. The best example is of the yeast and the morel. So these are the different types. You can see Penicillium also comes in this example. Aspergillus also comes. Now this is one of the example of Morcella, which also comes under the sac fungi. The third classification is Basidiomycete. Now they are also commonly known as club fungi. Their mycelium is there, that is septate, means wall septum is there, and highly branched. The reproductive structures are basidium. Now there, they do not have sporangiophore, instead they have basidium on which the spores or the fruiting bodies are formed. And these fruiting bodies are called as basidiocarps. Like we have zoospore, here we have basidiocarp. The best example is of agaricus or the common mushroom that we see. So this is one of the interesting examples. If you have seen this mushroom, you will find it has a covering that is called as pileus, a stalk, which is also known as type, and then we have the inner करते हैं. If you see the concave side of it, you will find they have gill-like structure, gill, like the fishing gill. And these gill, when we cut open, we find that they are actually bearing a large number of brachydium in which the brachydium pores are formed. These pores only when they are released, they will give rise to a new organism. Then we have the deuteromycetes. Now these organisms are kept in between because there we find that totally the sexual reproduction is absent. They are saprophytes or parasites, and their mycelium is well branched, and they possess the characteristic of the different classified forms. So that was the end of the classification of fungi. And now we have the reproduction. There are three modes of reproduction, as we know. Vegetative reproduction, which takes place by three modes. One is fragmentation. Here nothing happens, just a single hyphae breaks up into number of small fragments. Okay, and then each fragment will grow into a new individual. In fission, we find that a single hyphae bearing a nuclei will divide into two. So that is fission. And budding, you can see the diagram. You can see here, it is a very characteristic example of yeast. Now this is a single cell, I told you. And here you will find simply a extension developing here, as you can see here. An extension develops here, and the nucleus which is there, that also elongates. A part of the nucleus goes into this extended part, and then this wall compiles and completes inside and divides the yeast into two. So this forms like a bud which is still attached to the organism, and then it may separate from the parent cell. So this becomes the parent cell and this becomes the daughter cell if it separates from the parent. If it does not separate, it remains as a numerous bud-like structure. Like for example, one bud develops here, another bud from this will develop, and this way they may form an elongated structure. And if they separate, then they become a daughter cell. Now the asexual reproduction, we have already done a limited part. Here we find that the involvement of gametes is not there. So here we find, like I told you the example of rhizopus, where we have sporangium above and they bear sporangiospore or non-motile zoospore. Now these spores which are there, they are asexual fruiting bodies which will further, wherever they will drop. Like for example, when this sporangium burst open, you can see the spores are exposed, and then when they fall here and there and find a suitable medium like moisture, dampness, they will germinate and form a hyphae. You can see a single hyphae comes out which will further keep on branching. Ultimately, they form a mycelium. The next type of asexual reproduction occurs by method of conidia formation. Now conidia are also small structures, you can see, formed at the tip of the conidiophores. Now this is very common in all the penicillium, aspergillus, all these organisms, they bear conidiophore. Now instead of sporangiophore, they are having conidiophore, and instead of sporangiophore, they have conidia. So the only name difference is there and the structural difference is there. The last is the sexual reproduction under the reproduction types. And the first category is plasmogamy. Now because it involves the formation of two gametes, the two gametes should be there, that is male and female. Actually male and female is absent in the fungi. So they look or they behave as a different structure from the other. In the first category, we find plasmo. Plasma means the protoplast and gamy means fusion. So when two cells or two fungi, they come close and the fusion of the protoplast takes place, that it becomes one, that is called as plasmogamy. If the fusion of nucleus takes place and a new organism is formed, that is called as karyogamy. If we find that the two gametes, now, why we call them as two gametes? Because they may have some differences in their physiological structure, but morphologically they look alike, means they are very much similar in their appearance, but physiological, means functional wise, they are different. So aggregate, we find that when the fusion of such gametes occur, which are morphologically similar but physiologically different, they are called as iso. Iso means similar gamete. Anisogamy means when both ways, means physiologically also, means functional wise also, as well as appearance wise, means the male gamete may be having a smaller structure and the female may be having a bigger structure. So physiologically they are different, and this condition is called as anisogamy. The last is the oogamy. In oogamy we find that they develop specialized structure called as oogonium. So the hyphae which develops and forms oogonia is called as the female hyphae, and the one which will form the male gamete, or which is representing the male gamete, will form the entheroid. So likewise we find that they differ in their complete structure of the hyphae. So the female will be forming the oogonia, and thereby this condition is called as the oogamy. The last we have the economic importance of fungi. Now, according to your syllabus, you have only in the baking industry, in fungi, in the medicine field, and in the field of environmental decomposition. So there are many benefits of fungi given in the textbook, but you don't have to study all. The first category is fungi in baking industry. The common fungi is Saccharomyces. This is used to produce, because it has the tendency to produce ethyl alcohol and carbon dioxide, thereby it is used for making bread and cakes. Similarly, in the field of medicine, now there are many, you will see, a limited number I have shown here. The first is ergot. Ergot is obtained from fungi clavicus. Now this is a medicine. Now this ergot medicine is helped or is used in the induction of uterine contraction. And then we find here we have another medicine, ephedrine, which is synthesized from the yeast, and it is used in the treatment of asthma. Then we have vitamins, which are, many fungi are good source of vitamin, B12, B1, B2 and 4. Antibiotics. Now I have already told you penicillin. Penicillin is one of the wonder drugs that we call, which was the first wonder drug which was obtained from the fungi Penicillium notatum. Now fungi in environmental decomposition. As I have already told you, they are acting as scavengers because they decompose or they destroy the surrounding organisms, and thereby act as scavengers or cleaners of the environment. Second is biological control. They help in controlling the natural cycles of the surrounding by eliminating the waste from the environment. Then a role of mycorrhizae, means they act in association with higher plants. They form a structure called mycorrhizae, which we'll be studying in the coming days. And the last take in soil aggregation, means in binding the soil. So that's all for the topic, and I hope you have understood the kingdom fungi. And let us wait for some more topics to be covered up from the same chapter. And I hope you have understood well. Thank you and have a nice day.